Dear participants, welcome to the Modeling Meaning and Knowledge. This time the topic is conceptual change, and we will have two guest speakers. But before that, a short tutorial on studies of words and concepts. And first, some kind of trivialities. So let's talk about linguistics from the point of view of parts of speech. There we have open word classes, we have closed word classes. Here we don't pay much attention to the closed word classes because they basically serve as the functional words in language in order to serve purposes within inside the language. But open word classes typically refer to the external world and are interesting from that point of view, related to semantics and pragmatics. And there, if we think first about nouns, so for example in the area of artificial intelligence, there is a lot of focus on nouns. So the entities, objects, items of the words are often referred to with nouns in language. But naturally we have also the point of view given by the words, which are then referring to events, actions, whatever is happening. That's typically the connection within the semantic field. So the kind of syntactic distinctions within language, they typically refer to some kind of semantic distinctions too, including also adjectives, the qualities of the objects, entities, and as for example nowadays popular area of sentiment analysis, so that uses adjectives as its carrying force. When we move towards concepts, there was recently an event on conceptual change, and there was one philosopher, Kukkanen, who showed this kind of slide where there were words related to conceptual field, and he kind of stated that it's quite problematic that in different subdisciplines there are different concepts which refer to concepts, and then the kind of that creates kind of complex whole how to address it. There are various kinds of more or less standard ways of seeing this. Persian semiotics is one of those classical areas where the idea is that there is a triangle where there are objects, symbols, and then concepts between those. And then this kind of way of thinking is very popular, so there are hundreds and hundreds of different versions of the same triangular theme. So the idea is there that there are the symbols, which are, for example, the words in the language, there are those references in the world, some objects, and then there is the whatever conceptual item there in between, which is then the kind of intermediate, mediating object. Whether it's mental or not mental, that's one big question. There is also clear-headed thinking by Lev Vygotsky, who already about 100 years ago introduced various kinds of theories which can be useful even nowadays. His book Language and Thought is really recommended even nowadays. And his concept of zone of proximal development was introduced in the context of education, but it also can be used in the context of concepts and communication. So if you think about people who are not really familiar with some conceptual area or some domain of knowledge, so for them it's actually difficult to approach that domain without further study. And now this zone of proximal development is usually the area that one can approach having some education or having some support. And then there's this external area which is not really approachable, so that it's really kind of impossible to address. Some other views. So we have heard presentations related to semantic web. So the idea of representing knowledge in networks. And then we have also had presentations on representing knowledge in this kind of creation of spaces where the measurement of the space then indicates distance related to the knowledge. And there was also the possibility of considering external contexts outside of language. Now, if we think about various options that we have here, we can think about network-based representations, we can think about vector-based representations. Then we can take the view constructing these kind of representations by hand, manually, or being supported by machines, so kind of machine learning approach. Here we have the symbolic representation of networks on the left, and on the other hand we have on the right the presentation based on vectors, and here we kind of can compare these different four alternatives by maybe stating that the only impossible option is to construct really complex vector-based representations by hand. Because if you would have a matrix with millions or billions of items, so that it would make no sense to kind of have anybody to fill in that matrix or that structure by hand. So that's the only option which is not viable in this kind of structure. From the epistemological and ontological point of view, we can think about this kind of network representation that it easily leads into this kind of understanding of the world where the view on the world is shared by the humans or agents which are dealing with the world. And from the historical point of view related to research, so for example in computer science it has been very commonplace to use entity relationship models where the idea is that the world consists of items and the relationships between the items, and then the information systems are being constructed using this kind of basic structure and implemented. From the point of view of linguistics and philosophy, early Wittgenstein was proposing this kind of structure so that the items in the world, objects in the world, and the names in language relate to each other straightforwardly, and propositions in language, and then the state of the world, states of the world are kind of also in a one-to-one relationship. Richard Montague took this into a formal extreme where he really devised this kind of Montague grammar, which is famous and works very well, but it also has some problems because it's simplifying assumptions. Another point of view is such that the kind of complexities related to the world and to the human cognition are taken into account, so that there's no assumption that the kind of all people obtain the same kind of knowledge base, and that's why there are all kinds of complexities related to this setting and the epistemological and ontological setting. And for example, Maturana-Varela work is one of those important works in this area. Autopoiesis is one of those conceptual or the views or the theoretical constructions in this, and Heinz von Förster's work related to this area is also to be taken into account. There's a lot vast space of all kinds of theories and ideas related to this area, but I think this is sufficient for this introductory purpose.